But you all went on one tour, two tours maybe, so there's a lot of things we're all gonna be talking about. How many former FC students do I have here? Whoa, look at that. I'd say that's about 70% of the group. I figure I had 4,000 students at FC in 25 years. I taught courses that would have large sections sometimes, extended sections, later became Ephesians, Colossians. I taught upper division a lot. And I taught the First Corinthians class, and those were the regular ones that a lot of people would take. So anyway, it's good to see each of you. Appreciate you being here this evening. And it's been a long time since I've been able to teach. I think most of you know that I lost a little bit. And that was really, it took so long for her to depart from this life. She, of course, had Alzheimer's. I had that experience. My mother had Alzheimer's. And it's a great teacher. It can really teach you patience that I never thought I would have. And being said, I can never do this. We did this with another brother whose wife had Alzheimer's, but we were friends. And I thought about it, and I thought, I can never do what he's done. But we do things we don't know. So anyway, that was something that was a very difficult experience. And so because of that, I didn't teach much in the years of having spent time caring for her. And then came the pandemic. And so I taught a couple of fill-in classes here. And I taught and preached over at the university one evening, some things like that. So I may have forgotten what to do. I think they say it's time for class to start. And I'm so glad you're here, and I hope you'll enjoy the class. If you don't like geography, there's plenty of room down here. If you don't like geography, then you won't like the first two classes. And then if you like, other things, well, we'll get to that. So please don't give up in the event that you don't care for the first part. So I hope that we can go along the way. We'll have two classes. I'm just getting acquainted with the system here. We'll have two classes, and then we'll have a break during the, well, that's the school up the street, you know. So we'll have the break then for the singing and so on, the speaker and whatever. And then after that, we'll get started back, and maybe not so many breaks after that time. Paulette and I are going, Lord willing, at the end of this class. We've postponed our trip until we hope this class is over. First week it's over. So stay with me and help us get it over. I'll be her guide, and she can go with me to any place we want to go. I've made a lot of trips like that, and I made 84, I believe, foreign tours I led. Some of those were to South Pacific, some were to Asia, some were to Europe, but most of them were to the Bible land, either Israel, Turkey, Greece, and so on. And so there's a lot of things to learn in those places. And I still go back. I've been going every year. I went last March. It was the last time a year ago in March. Yeah, that's last year. So March hasn't gotten here yet, has it? So I made that trip, and I always go places that either I haven't been in a long time, or something new has been discovered, or someplace that, you know, haven't been involved. And people ask me a lot of times, you know, what can you see after you've been all that many times? You know, 50-plus times, I don't even know how to count it. And many more than that, in fact, if I count their stayovers and, you know, staying an extra 2 weeks or whatever to visit in the land just here and there. And the fact is, my list grows longer of the things I still want to see than it was maybe when I started, because I know of all these places that I'd like to go and I haven't had the opportunity to be there. So, anyway, let's begin our class with prayer at this time. Now, Father in heaven, thank you so much for the blessing you give us. Thank you for allowing us to have this class. We pray it will be beneficial to each person who is here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Now, as we think about this, I want you to realize in discussing these things that there's a reason for them. And the reason is not to show you something that somebody is doing today somewhere that is like it was in Bible times. That's not what it's about. It's about learning to understand the Bible better. It's about learning what Bible people did that will help us to have a better grasp of that reality, that truth, and then make us better Bible students. And in being better Bible students, hopefully, the lesson this morning, hopefully, that it will allow us to be better servants of the Lord. So, let's begin, and as I said, it will be a little bit difficult, maybe a little different at first, and then after that, hopefully, it'll all can work out real well. And I see Les, he's been on my Bible reading tour also. He and Linda, both of them.
Right? And you've been to our home in Africa.
I have. That's good. They invited me. I took a tour down there in about 1990 and then stayed over a period of time and preached at almost every church in the country. And that's a pretty good thing, moving around and you know, doing that. I really enjoy it. So, this is an old path in Samaria. Samaria, Jesus went through Samaria, and whether he went to a specific town that we read about in the Bible, he went to some nearby. So I can imagine in my mind that Jesus took a road like this, that this is the way he walked about from place to place. And imagine walking all the way from Nazareth to Jerusalem. Now you say, well, I looked it up on the map, and it's about 75 miles. Yes, that's right. But he had to go a certain way. He had to go on the mountain route, or he had to go in the valley. And so it was a lot further than that, and it was a trip that took about, well, you can say 20 miles a day at the most. Imagine walking 20 miles a day. And so you can figure then it took him 4 days for sure to go from Nazareth to Jerusalem. And you got to stop, find water, maybe at the well. You've got to be able to find food and all these things that you will need. You even have to be able to find a place that's suitable to sleep at night. And so those are important things to consider. You might remember this. I saw this on TV, the whole series. I remember, I don't know how many years ago this was. But this guy, Bruce Feiler, or Feiler, wrote a book and called Walking the Bible. I saw him also on the Today Show, and it was the series was on our PBS here, locally at WDU, and I'm sure all over the country. And what he wanted to do was to begin where the story begins, in Ur of Chaldees. We're not sure about where that was, but he went to the traditional place in southern Iraq. It could have been in the north. And so he went there and then he walked that. And maybe he had provisions made so that because it was being filmed and so on, and you know, production maybe he was allowed to cross in ways that others might not be able to. But I remember Brother Haley used to say to me, "Farrell, I'd like to go with you. I want to go with you someday." But he never did. And he said, "I'd like to start where Abraham started and just go exactly like he did and follow that around." And I said, "Brother Haley, that sounds good, but you can't do that. There are political things in the Middle East that make it impossible even to go from Israel into Lebanon. You just can't do it. And so you're going to have to find out some other way to learn all of these things." So anyway, he did finally go with Brother Colt, but never was able to go like he wanted to go. And like a lot of us, we enjoy going. So here's what Filer said about this, and it's, of course, very correct. He said, "These are real places, real stories." He said, "The land is so central to the story." And that is true, of course, that it is that way. And here's what we're going to study, the kind of things. We're going to talk about choosing a place to live. How do you pick a place to live? Well, I live close to Florida College. A lot of people say that. Yeah. So they move down north and live there. I want to live close to Temple Terrace Church building. I want to live close to this or that. And so people come to a certain place. They want a place, they can get a good job. Don't have to drive so far to work. All kinds of good reasons. And we think of the Bible characters. And as we go along, we'll be explaining some of the situations whereby we see how they chose a place to live and how significant that was in where they went. And then all the things you've got to have when you go there. You know, you've got to have water, you've got to have food, you've got to have a place that you can material to deal with, and so on. So here are the kinds of things we'll study. We'll talk about some occupations and trades that are common in Bible times. We will talk about agriculture. I love this one. I lived and raised on a farm, and I really enjoyed the agriculture there and the agriculture here. I was glad to get away from it. You know, when you've gotten on your knees and crawled down, and today cotton is just like this in Alabama, at least. You know, it's real low, so a machine can go along and pick it. But it was high when I was a little kid. And you pull a sack on your back there, you know, and you're going along and picking cotton. And I, even as a young kid, I picked 125 to 50 pounds a day. So it was a good bit of work. And then you got to ride on the cotton to go to the gym, but you had to get off before they pulled them. That wouldn't have worked too well. So anyway, we all had various experiences like that. Not all of us, but some of us have. And it's really a wonderful experience. There are trees and plants and various crops, and we need to know what they ate. You know, we may not understand why certain things are said in the Bible, why they mention certain foods, but their food was limited. Very limited amount of food, number, right? They had plenty to eat most of the time, but they were not a broad variety. Even, and I'm sure Les and Karen can tell us that this is true, I have known several instances where a lady comes back from overseas, living overseas, working with her husband and preaching, and probably in other ways as well. And they come back home and they go to the grocery and they're just there 14 varieties of corn in the can. And over there, they were glad to get corn. Just one, you know. Or they have to go to the market every day in order to get the fresh things that are available to cook those. And so it is so different in the, when you have the limited amount of things that you would eat. We'll talk about animal husbandry. We'll talk about the food that people ate and gave the animals, the clothing people had. This has to do with the animals as well, you know, because you've got this clothing that comes from the sheep. and certain things come from the goat skins and so on, and the production of the clothing and how that was done. We can show you examples of people doing that today, still using the same methods that they used in Bible times. Usually it's just to show, but nonetheless, it is the real thing. And then there were metalworks, and then the potter. I have one entire lesson on the potter and the pottery, and I think you'll enjoy that when we can come to that and do that. And we'll talk about city building. We'll talk about housing and water systems. And the water systems are just fantastic. As we talk about finding a place to live, you had to find a place where you had food and water. And so how are you going to get water? Well, yeah, that's the one. That was not intentional. Make a note of that. My students all thought that I had to laugh here or joke here in the margin, but it was not true. Things just come to me. So there are different things that they were able to do, you know, and they had to get water, and so what would they do? Well, they would either dig a well, they would dig a very deep pit. I'll be showing you some of these, very deep pit, half the size of this room. I'm talking about in this dimension, and then the depth of it, and then building steps to go down to get the water when the water level was low. And so on. So all that had to be taken into account when they moved in. They didn't just say, oh, I'll go down to City Hall and make a deposit, and they'll turn it on tomorrow. It wasn't like that at all. And so that was very chief in understanding where one is going to live. There's travel and transportation, of course, limited in those ways. Culture, things like athletics and entertainment, music and art, and games and toys, and even warfare is very significant. People do doctoral dissertations on warfare in Bible times and write books about it. And those things are significant. Of course, we'll only be touching a few little highlights of the thing. There's writing material also that we will try to talk about. I'm not sure we'll get to all these things, but I hope we'll get to many of them. And what they wrote on, what kind of material they wrote on, the pens they used, the seals. We'll learn about health and about the diseases and death and burial in Bible times, some of those at least. We'll talk some about religions, if we can, the pagan religions, more than what we read in the Bible. And then the thing they had to contend with their neighbors and so on. And then we'll talk about marriage and the family, if time permits for that as well. I wanted to tell you, I don't know whether I have any handouts or not. I might, but if I do, there'll be punch 3 holes so that you can put them in a binder of some kind. One of those little dual tang is what I call it, down at the bottom there. You know, you can put it in something like that and keep them all together. And then the land of Israel, I have another series that I use that is called the Fifth Gospel. And this is about Israel and how Israel is like a fifth gospel, not just Israel, but the whole Bible lands. It is like a fifth gospel in the sense that it harmonizes with the four gospels and all of these things that it talks about and all the things they talk about, that there is an agreement of book and land. I wanted to tell you about the first Holy Land tour, as some people call it. I always call it Bible Land, though it is a Holy Land because God made it that. He chose it that way. But I always prefer to call it the Bible Land for our purposes, the kind of people that go with me. And in Genesis 12 and verse 1, the Bible says that the Lord said to Abram, go forth from your country, and from your relatives and from your father's house to the land that I will show you. So he's got a big trip coming up on him there.
And then as you go on, he's told in Genesis 13, once he arrives in the land some years later, he's told to arise and walk through the length and the breadth of the land, for I will give it to you. That's quite a distance, because in the biblical terminology, it's from Dan in the north to Beersheba in the south, and of course the land actually is even longer than that today. It would be from Mount Hermon to Eilat on the Red Sea. So that's quite a big distance to be going and be walking. There is a little book, I've forgotten the lady's name now, a lady from Eilat and her husband. And she wrote the book called Walk the Land. And it's a fascinating book as they tell about walking the whole distance. There's a national trail in Israel that you can walk. But the Bible land is much more than that, much more than just Israel, of course, and we need to realize that. That's Leon Maul. Leon had traveled with me, and when I quit leading tours or decided that long before that, I wanted to continue to go to the land and make special trips, because you can't take a large group of, let's say, elderly people. Most of the time, the folks on the tour are older than me, and I remember having a tour where I was the youngest person in the group, and the reason is because it's expensive, and a lot of folks who are still working, raising family at home, you just don't have the money to go. I understood that always, and so I was glad to be able to have younger couples able to go, and especially, I always loved having those who were teachers, and that includes women teachers, the ladies, because in the classes, you can use this material in your classes in a way that the children can learn from them in a good way. So Leon and I, he's traveled with me more than anybody on these personal trips, and he also is a tour leader now, and Luke Chandler is, he went with me, and also Barry Brunel. They're all good men, and all do good tours. I wanted to tell you this, and I could do a whole series on this subject, but I'm just using it a little bit now to illustrate a point. J.W. McGarvey wrote a book on the Bible lands, and he tells about his impression of that back in 1879 when he visited Palestine. Imagine visiting Palestine. I mean, you're talking about, it took a week for the ship to get across, you know, almost a week to go across to the Atlantic. And then once they get there, how do they travel? They travel on horseback. Maybe they could go by wagon sometime with several people going, but mostly it's just by horseback. Then what do you got to do? Well, all we talked about before, you got to stop at a place that has some degree of safety. You have to have water. You have to have a place you can get your food. You have to carry a cook with you that will cook the food once you get to this place, and on. Real problems. It was not easy to travel in those days. And his students in Lexington, Kentucky, at the College of the Bible, his former students, paid for his trip with the understanding that he would write the book, The Lands of the Bible. And it was published, and I don't remember at the moment, but it was published by one of the major publishers. In other words, it wasn't, you know, I know that the bookstore would publish my material. It wasn't like that. It was that there was a major publisher. And so that meant that there would be other people who would use this material and so on. And so he said in this chapter he wrote on argument from agreement of land and book, he said some things that were rather significant. He said that there is a general agreement between the Bible and the geography of Palestine is a well-known fact. Its plains, mountains, valleys, rivers, lakes, cities, and deserts are all in part, of the Bible correctly named and correctly located. Let's think about that. I mean, when people say that this book was made up and written later on, centuries later, by somebody who said, I'm writing for Luke back here in the first century, or I'm writing for Matthew. It's just impossible that it could be that way when you look at the accuracy of what they have said. He says that the political divisions known to exist are invariably recognized, as are also all the changes of government through which the country passed in the course of its long, varied history. So it's an amazing thing that this has happened. In not a single known instance, from the beginning to the end of the book, is there a failure in any one of these particulars. Not a failure in any of them. And I see these every time I go, things like this, how accurate the Bible is in describing these things. If somebody was living in Europe 300 years later writing this book, they wouldn't know these things. There are details that they just simply did not know because they had never been there. I hear preachers regularly. I hear Bible class teachers when I travel to those places. Bible class teachers make mistakes that they wouldn't make if they'd even been to the land. And certainly, this would be the case in regard to this. So, the fifth gospel, the agreement of book and land. There was another man, an unbeliever. This man was Ernest Mann. And he was an unbeliever, as I said. And in 1861, he visited the land of Palestine or Israel. Its name did vary through the centuries, of course. And at that time, it would be Palestine that he's talking about. And he said, before my eyes, as I traveled around the land, I had a fifth gospel that I was able to look at. And he said, all this history, which seems out of distance to float in the clouds of an unreal world, took on thus a form, a solidity, in which astonished me. And so this is something that was amazing to him, even though he had not believed that Jesus was even a real person at that point. Then he said, the striking agreement of the text and the places, the marvelous harmony of the gospel idea with the country, I think that should be ideal, with the country which served it as a framework, were to me a revelation. He said, before my eyes, I had a fifth gospel, torn, but still a legend. And from that time, through the narratives of Matthew and Mark, I saw instead of an abstract being who might be said never to have existed, an admirable human figure living and moving. Isn't that amazing? That the land impressed this unbeliever that much. And so this is the agreement of book and land. There's a man named Bartle Pixner, there was. He is deceased now. And, they're deceased, obviously. But he lived in Israel for more than a quarter of a century. He was working mostly, though he did some archaeological work in the country. He lived at a little place called Tapta, which is a traditional place for the feeding of 5,000. May not be the right spot, but you're never far from the right spot. That's the thing that's important. It may not be this spot, it might be over there another 2 miles, but you're always close. On my tours, I always said to people, I could get them to doing this, okay, this is where such and such happened. And if it wasn't here, it was here. So they got to where they could do that too. People have to learn. And that's the way it is. It's here. It's close by, the things that we're talking about. And I met Pixner one time. I have two of his books that are identical, I believe. I already had one, and I bought one that day so he would sign it. And so, what do you do with books like that? I have some of those books, you know, and I hate it. I just can't imagine giving them away, getting rid of them. And that's a very significant book. So he wrote With Jesus Through Galilee, according to the fifth gospel. Now, he said, so the soil of the Holy Land, as the scene of the events centering around the person of Jesus, can be understood as a fifth gospel. As others, like Ruman, I'm sure he was thinking of, have already used them. And then whoever has learned to read, that's what it says. We wouldn't say it that way, but other people say things differently. Whoever has learned to read and peruse this book of biblical landscape will experience the message of the four gospels with a new and greater clarity. So when you see it, you understand the Bible better. Because you say, that's just exactly what it is. And most of us who go, we go to places and we stop here to say, this is a certain place, and here's the biblical text, and we start reading the biblical text. Wow. That was right here. Yes, thank you. That's where that happened. And often we know these things. He says the knowledge of the geography and the contemporary history of 2 millennia ago makes it clear that the history of a real man is being described, and not just the literary construction of an ideal person. So not just some make-believe person. 5 gospels record the life of Jesus. 4 you will find in books, and 1 in the land they call holy. Read the 5th gospel, and the world of the 4 will open to you. This, of course, is true. My experience is something like this. I never had a teacher until I went to graduate school that had done the Bible with. I studied at Athens Bible School for 4 years. I studied at Florida College for four years, Florida Christian College, you know what it's called then. And my brother Haley, who taught the Bible geography that I took, he had not been. Clinton Hamilton had not been. None of them had been. I learned a lot of Bible. I had about 100 hours of Bible when I left with a certificate of achievement, because they were not offering a bachelor's degree at that time. It was the same difference. So then I went to graduate school several years later. Just 7 years later, I've been preaching a while, and I went to Harding School of Religion, Harding School of Theology now, I think it's called, in Memphis, and I had every teacher had been in my life. Every teacher I had. And Lewis had been repeatedly, had been a scholar at the Albright Institute in Jerusalem, had done archaeological work, been a fellow there for a year, so he spent time in the land. And I saw a difference. I didn't learn any more Bible, but I understood what I learned better after I had a teacher like that. And so then I realized, and people often ask me, well, what caused you to decide to go? And I thought the reason was because I saw what a difference it. And I saw that as a preacher of the gospel, and someone who wanted to come to teach at Florida College, I thought, I've got to do this. So, young preachers don't have any money. None whatsoever. Right? I don't see there any young preachers. Will the preachers say amen to that? They don't have any money. So how are you going to go? Well, later on it came that there were a lot of people who would say, I'd like to help the preacher go. And they did. But in my case, and I had a friend in Indianapolis named William Wallace, Bill Wallace, son of Coy Wallace, and he and I talked about wanting to go. His experience was different, but he'd been preaching and realized that lot to learn. So we decided that we would get together a group. And we did. We took 19 people that first trip. And that was in 1967. So that is the travel that I began. And I put in the little note how many years ago that was. You have to figure it out. All I can do, I can't do it. So anyway, quite some time ago, beginning to learn about the land. And I went in 80, I was, we were the first I was the person to take the lead in it and try to earn the money so we could go. I'd done several trips by that time. Melvin Curry had been by that time. Also, he went in 66, though I didn't even know Melvin at that time, but he had been in 66. And so, you know, I went in 67, then I came here to teach in 69. And I participated in this archaeological excavation along with, they're all deceased now, unfortunately, Phil Roberts. And Phil got active in it and went to a lot of different digs, stayed over a number of years. He'd go every summer. And then there was Harold Taper, and there was Jim Hodges. And only I remember. So anyway, that's the little square I worked in at Lakish. And that in the corner that you see over here somewhere. See if I can get this over in the corner. Where's the corner? Right there. Right there, there's a big rock there. And there was an oven there. And I found some really significant stuff. I found a fish bone that big. Well, what did that do? Well, they came around and explained this to me. We were 10 miles from the Mediterranean Sea. And they said, this is a sea fish. So I learned, one day, some guy came over to Gaza or somewhere like that. And he's out there with his wagon. And he says, fresh fish, fresh fish. The husband says to the wife, would you like me to get some fresh fish? She said, yes, I can cook it tonight if you'll clean it. And so that's how this started. Right? I mean, see how it works. We know how these things work. Because on the farm, we killed hogs, but we never killed beef. But other people would. And they'd come by, and he'd sell it to you, one of those scales, you know, like this. And so you'd say, okay, well, I'll take this. And you'd tell them what part of meat you want. And that's the way we got our meat on the farm when I was a kid. That chicken's all right. Oh, I used to eat at home. It's pretty good. They said, you're going home with us today, Brother Jenkins. Good. We can go over there. And then the lady goes out in the backyard, grabs the chicken. Or does that. Either way, it works. And so you got to wait, what, 2 hours? I don't know. How long would that take? From the time you kill it until the time you can eat it. It was quite a while, so that's the way it worked. So you learn these things, it's just little simple things that show you this. And then, of course, I've made a special point of studying about the land and all of these things. There is a long chapter in the Evidences Introduction to Christian Evidences. Some of you had that club course that I taught for 15 years, and it's been revised. And is available once again at the college bookstore. It wasn't available for a long time. So I mentioned about a place to live. Here we are. Job opportunities, climate, transportation. I'm tired of this cold weather. Are you? No, some of you like it. I just freeze in this weather. And all these things we look for. I must be going back here. I don't think I am. Let's talk a little bit about the geography of the Bible world. There was a guy at the University of Chicago several years back who called this area that we're talking about the fifth gospel. The fifth gospel. So the way, not the fifth gospel, he called this the fertile crescent. So here's what we do. We start with Abraham, maybe here, in ancient Sumer, in Ur of Chaldea. And then we move up past Babylon. Notice the greenery. Notice the way it goes. Abraham goes up here. Abraham might have lived right up in here. There are Bible atlases that place over there in that vicinity. And so then he comes to this area, Aram. And then after a period of time there, in that Padan Aram, and the no family stayed there, because later on they have to go back there to get the wives or the boys, and they have to go there to get their wives. And so we continue, we come all around like this, and we come down to Damascus, and we come on down to the Jordan River, and we cross the Jordan River, and we go to Jerusalem. But they didn't go to Jerusalem, in fact. They went to Shechem. Both Abraham, I believe, based on what we read, and also we know that Jacob and his family went there. So you can learn the route of travel. Because why? Well, people just didn't go across. What happened here? People didn't go. People did not go across that nation. There is a road now from Jordan, the country of Jordan, over to Iraq. You know, the military made that needful back in those days. And so there is a way that you can travel across there now. But the average person taking a trip is not going to do it. Did you see Queen of the Desert with Nicole Kidman? Notice I can mention people like Nicole Kidman. Slips off my Queen of the Desert. If you haven't seen it, and you're interested at all in that kind of life, how the Middle East was divided up after World War I, it's a very interesting film. It's a story, really, about Gertrude Bell, who was from Oxford, had graduated at Oxford, and she wanted to go to Persia to learn. And she did. And she wanted to go out into the desert to learn. And she did. And finally, she was a cohort, a co-worker, co-time with Lawrence of Arabia. And finally, when it got around to Britain and France and Italy and all the countries divided up the Middle East, as they did after World War I, when it got to that time, they said, that woman can tell us where to draw the lines, because she had been in there. She had lived there. And so she knew where the lines could be. This tribe gets along. This tribe, not this. And that's why the lines were drawn. You'll notice that there are three lines that are just straight. And then there are others that are like the river. And those are things that are really interesting. Now, so look what happens over here. You've got the Fertile Crescent. The Fertile Crescent we're talking about. It's the green. You see that? Now you come on down past Damascus. It's on the edge of the desert. And you come right down and you go over here. Now look over there. There's a great city. Just a little bit of strip. A little strip. Even in Israel, you've got the wilderness of Judea between the greenery and the river. People don't live there. Just some Bedouin who want to take their sheep and go there and eat grass that's left over. And so that's real important. People had to live where they could. And maybe I have another word here. We've got another word to use. I don't know if I got it on this one or not. What's the other word I'm looking for? The sown and the desert. See those words? The sown, that's where you can plant crops. The only time we know of people traveling across there in biblical times is when they had an opportunity to go across or needed to make a rush loop. How long did it take to go from Babylon to Jerusalem? How long did it take to go? The Bible tells you. What books would we turn to for that information? Ezra and Nehemiah. 4 months. 4 months. Is that first, second, third?
First.
Got 5 minutes? Maybe. We'll see. Good. All right, so it took that long for them to go. And that's where the significance is. So there it is, Ezra chapter 7, verses 8 and 9. I believe in 7, 8, and 9. And it took 4 months for them to travel across the desert. And there was no quick way to get to it. No trains, no air cushion coaches. It took a long time. And look at the map here that comes from NASA. Pictures that are made. So what do we have with these pictures that are made? See, where are we at? Over here. See that? See, there's the Dead Sea. There's the Sea of Galilee. And there's the lot right there with the Red Sea. The Gulf of the Lot from the Gulf of Aqaba, depending on which country you're in, what you call it. So that's it. So that's what it looks like from space. And you can see that very few people are going to live out in that desert. So now, when we talk about a place to live, of course, the Lord told Abraham where to move in, right? He moved all of his movement. I want you to go here. I want you to go to this place. I want you to go to this place. But still, it had to be a place where he could find these things. He had to dig wells. And so, so here are the countries. Look at the countries now that you can see. This includes Iran, a little bit. That's Persia, not so much. Then we have Iraq. Then go up to Turkey. I've been all over Turkey, from one end to the other, from one north to south, the whole country. And there's a place or two, mainly in the Bible, I haven't visited, but for the most part, almost every one of them. And so you go here to Syria, Lebanon, and look at what you have in Syria and Lebanon, something that is very significant. Right there. You see those two little white streaks above the end? That's two mountain ranges. One of them, to your left, are the Mediterranean. That's the Lebanon Mountains. Then you go through, if you're going to the east, which is over here, you go down into the valley. That's the Bica Valley, or Bica Valley. Then the other one is the Anti-Lebanon Mountains. Now it's going to be significant that we are going to in this Anti-Lebanon over on this side, that's where Mount Hermon is located, right there. That's going to affect the weather in Israel, because it's, even the Bible says that Jerusalem is blessed by the dew of Hermon. So it's going to be significant. And then you have Lebanon with the, all the, between the coast and the mountain. And then you have a valley, and then you have Syria with a little bit of that, and then the rest of it is in the desert. And then the same thing is going to happen. Watch how this happens. This mountain range here, did I do the wrong thing? Did I move it? All right, so you look at this. This mountain range is going to come right down through the center of Israel. Like that. This mountain range is going to come down over here in Jordan, and it's going to be what we call the Transjordan Plateau. So all of what is going to happen in Israel is determined by this land that is up above. So that's rather significant. That's the geography. It wasn't as bad as you thought it would be. And then if you go on to Egypt, look down how few places you have that are vegetation. You have the land of Egypt, the delta. This is the delta up here, right there. And Goshen is in that area, right there. So Israel lived there. And God didn't want them to go across like that. They had come across somewhere here over into Jordan, and it was a hard way to go. Hard way to go. He had to give them water out of the rock. He had to give them manna to eat. See that? There's some places you can't live unless you have divine help. And that's what he did for them there. And so you see down in Egypt, now the only other vegetation you have, the only other green, this is also satellite, is that you have the Fayum, a little desert area, oasis here, and you have the Nile River. And what is said about the Nile River, Egypt is what? The gift of the Nile. Egypt is the gift of the Nile. If it weren't for the Nile, there just wouldn't be any vegetation. I farmed along the Nile River going twice, going to certain parts. And you look down, and you'll see places where the greenery comes all the way to the river. And then you'll go other places where it's back from the river a little bit. Or that will only stretch out for a few miles. You know, 2 or 3 miles, 5 miles at the most. Then after that, what do you have? The Sahara then. And we get the sand here at least once a year. We always talk about this is from the Sahara Desert. And it's that sand that's coming across. They live in all the time. Well, have you learned anything? Huh? I thought she had her hands up. I am so pleased with you. Thank you for coming tonight. I hope you'll come back. And we've got about 6 seats left, so invite a friend.